Ladies and gentlemen, we're proud to welcome you to the 2015 NCLR Economic Town Hall. NCLR would like to thank City and Prudential, our co-lead sponsors for today's event. We would now like to introduce the Managing Director of City Community Development and Inclusive Finance and a longtime dedicated community advocate, Natalie Abatemarco.
Thank you. Thank you. On behalf of City, I'd like to thank NCLR's President, Janet Murguia, and Board Chair, Renata Soto, for providing me with this opportunity to speak with you for a moment about our shared commitment to the economic advancement of the Hispanic community. Over the years, our national and local NCLR affiliate partnerships across the country have taught us a few things at City. The Mission Asset Fund in San Francisco showed us that culturally competent, relevant financial services and training can help thousands of the unbanked save money and repay small loans, all while building a credit score. The Committee for Hispanic Children and Families in New York City revealed a renewed opportunity for strengthening the city's childcare system by improving the capacity and the business operations of Latina entrepreneurs providing daycare services. And one of our more recent initiatives was born from the lessons learned from the partnership with affiliate Casa de Maryland. We agreed that citizenship is an asset for economic mobility, and citizenship, a national identity, also requires a financial identity. So not too long ago, we joined with Mayor Rahm Emanuel, Los Angeles Mayor Eric Garcetti, and New York City Mayor Bill de Blasio, and two national partners to launch Cities for Citizenship, an effort aimed to enable cities, especially mayors, to expand delivery of naturalization services and financial counseling services, including access to small loans. As a global institution operating in 160 countries, we at City get it. We all know that the economic benefits span far beyond individuals who achieve naturalization. But in fact, the naturalization would provide some $50 billion to boost the national economy over 10 years. To me, that's money. That's real money. And so now more mayors are getting it. Almost 20 mayors have signed on. And if you hear your city, please raise your hand. Atlanta, Baltimore, Boston, Chattanooga, Chicago, Denver, Los Angeles, Nashville, New York, Milwaukee, Philadelphia, Reading, Seattle, and Washington, D.C. Okay, give yourselves a round of applause. Now, if you didn't raise your hands, I encourage you and your cities to join this movement to improve the lives and economic opportunity for Latinos. For more information, we encourage you to visit citiesforcitizenship.org. Thank you so much for giving me this time, and enjoy the program.
Thank you, Natalie. With an extensive professional background and dedicated support of social issues, we would now like to introduce Senior Vice President of Human Resources for Prudential, Sharon Taylor.
Thank you very much, and thank you all for joining us here today at this town hall for this important dialogue. I am delighted to be here on behalf of Prudential to participate in this important discussion about the economic challenges facing Latinos, and importantly, to talk about some promising solutions to these challenges. You know, Prudential's 17-year partnership with NCLR is really reflective of who we are as a firm. We have a legacy of serving underserved communities to help them build secure financial foundations so that they can survive and even thrive. For the last 140 years, we have been a company who has held true to our principles. We were founded upon the principle of being the first company in the country to provide affordable insurance for working families. And to this day, we remain focused on expanding access to knowledge, to tools, to assets, to help individuals and communities become financially secure. And certainly, as a nation, we all know that we have work to do. For many Latinos, the need to focus on immediate financial needs is uppermost in their minds. This tough reality is made worse by the fact that two-thirds of Latino workers are unable to participate in employer-based retirement savings programs and systems. And we know that these employer-based systems go a long way and are a vital factor to helping secure financial stability and upward mobility. So it's this important reality that, if left unaddressed, will create increased vulnerabilities for this ever-fast-growing population of people, and will not only affect Latinos' finances, but the economy at large. Let's face it, when we all do well, does not America do well? This is why our partnership with NCLR and enlightened public policy partners and key stakeholders is so very critical. Most recently, the Prudential Foundation supported NCLR's latest study, Enhancing Latino Retirement Resources in California. The study presents an assessment of retirement readiness of Latinos and an evaluation of California's Secure Choice Retirement Savings Program to improve the retirement prospects for Latinos. In May, Prudential partnered with NCLR executives to host a panel discussion and a news conference to build awareness around these findings. The panel was moderated by Carmen Rita Wong, co-creator and host of CNBC's On the Money. As part of this research, the study provides additional considerations and recommendations for policymakers and anyone interested in implementing similar practices. So if you've heard from my colleagues from Citi and other key stakeholders throughout the course of this conference, it does not take the reinvention of the wheel to have an impact. Throughout our longstanding partnership, Prudential has served as a public policy partner on the board of corporate advisors, and we are an original sponsor of the Alamo Award. So our 17-year affiliation with NCLR is broad and is deep. NCLR, under the leadership of Janet Merguia and her ABLE team, is the go-to organization for policy and advocacy issues for the Latino community. We are proud to continue this long-standing partnership, and we are even more proud to working with Latinos to ensure that they have the resources and tools necessary to achieve their financial security. Thank you all for being here today and for lending your voices to this important dialogue. Enjoy the rest of the program.
It is our esteemed honor to now introduce one of the most influential Latina businesswomen in the country. Serving on President Barack Obama's Council of Jobs and Competitiveness, she's also the chair for the board of directors for U.S. Hispanic Media Incorporated. Please welcome our moderator, Monica Lozano.
Thank you. Thank you all for being here, and we have a topic that will be touched upon in this town hall, which I know is today one of the most important topics in our country, and that of income inequality and the growing wealth gap. And because it's such a timely and topical subject, we've put together an extraordinary panel for you that will deal with the subject not just from the point of view of the problem, and we know it's a growing problem, but what are some of those solutions that we can turn to collectively to try to close this income gap and make sure that all boats are rising. I'll introduce the panel in just a minute, but I want to first thank our sponsors for supporting this, our co-lead sponsors, both Prudential and Citi. And as you heard, these are companies that are absolutely committed, whether it's improving our retirement savings or being on the ground with Cities for Citizenship. I want to thank both of you for making this town hall possible. And it's now my great pleasure to kick this off by introducing our keynote speaker. And I can't think of a better way to segue to this town hall than coming out of the Latinas brunch. And as we think about women leadership and what it takes to tackle the tough issues of the day. We have an extraordinary keynote speaker with us today, the U.S. Treasurer, Rosy Rios. And Rosy Rios serves as the 43rd Treasurer of the United States. She has direct oversight over the U.S. Mint, the Bureau of Engraving, and Fort Knox, and is a key liaison to the Federal Reserve. She also serves as a Secretary's advisor to the Secretary for Community Development and Public Engagement, and is especially passionate about supporting women in finance. And before Rosy was confirmed as treasurer, she worked in this area of financial access, financial improvement for all communities with McFarland Partners, which is a global development and capital partnership. And there she was involved in everything from insurance to real estate to access to capital and, of course, ensuring that we participate in this growing economic opportunity. But I wanted, and I think you have Rosy's full bio in your program, but I wanted to take a step back and just say a few things about her also as an individual. Rosy was one of nine children. She was raised by a single mother who was born in Mexico and came to the United States in the 1950s. And early on in her life, Rosy, like so many of young children, actually worked in the fields. She worked in the fields harvesting crops in Northern California, and yet her mother believed absolutely in the power of education. And of all nine children, went on to college. Rosy graduated from Harvard, and that launched, of course, her career, but she never forgot where she came from. And as many of you know, now there's a big conversation about putting a woman's image on our bills, right? The $10 bill. And I listened to an interview that Rosy did with Fortune magazine. And when they asked her, well, who do you think should be on that $10 bill? She said, well, my mother, of course. So it is my privilege and my honor to introduce our keynote speaker, the Honorable Rosy Rios, Treasurer of the United States.
Thank you so much, Monica. That was such a gracious introduction. Very, very nice of you, and thanks for plugging my mom. As much as I would love to put her on the $10 bill, unfortunately she would have to be deceased. So that is not going to happen anytime soon. But yes, she is absolutely an inspiration for me and continues to be, along with my 14-year-old daughter. So thank you so much. And thank you to Janet and NCLR for this invitation. I've been a big supporter of NCLR long before I came into the administration almost 7 years ago. When I was part of the Treasury Federal Reserve transition team starting in November of 2008. I am now the longest serving senior Treasury official in this administration. I think I've outlasted several of my colleagues by two and three generations worth. So it's been an amazing experience. I stand here today. I love that you still show the picture of me from 6 years ago because I appreciate that. But it's been an amazing haul, and what I thought I would do for you today is provide a little bit of a 30,000-foot overview of the economy, dig down a little deeper into what it's like for the Latino community, and then talk specifically about some of the programs that have come into place in this administration, and then end with a few of the very specific initiatives that we are focusing on today, in fact, here at NCLR. And I know you have a panel that follows me, so I don't want to reinvent the wheel, but what I did ask our economic policy team to put together with us was some of the salient points that we think will be helpful for the start of this next panel. And what I love about this information is, believe it or not, we may have been the first administration to actually dig down a little deeper in terms of what's important to our community, specific to Latino economic statistics. So I'm thrilled to share that with you today. And because I am the first person in the history of any administration to be a senior advisor to the Secretary on Community Development, these are issues that are near and dear to my heart, whether it's job creation, access to capital, small business lending. So again, thank you for this invitation, and thank you for what all of you do. I know I am not the only person that was raised by a single mom in this room. And I know I'm not the only Latina or Latino that comes from a family of 9 kids, and I know I'm not the only person who stresses the value of a good education. So to all of us, thank you for what you all do. So I wanted to start by giving a little bit of some information on the last few years and where we stand today. So most recently, Treasury just commemorated the 5-year anniversary of Wall Street reform. We know that it was very essential in order to get our economy on track. And if you obviously read the papers every day, you see these aren't just domestic issues, these are international issues. And so the role that we play, not just in our own communities, but to set the pattern for the global economy is very, very important. We know that there's a lot more that needs to be done, and we know that growth takes time. And remember, growth is always the operative word. Coming from a family of 9, no one knows that better than I do. But growth is certainly key. But we are currently seeing some indicators that are positive. So we do know that the labor markets continue to improve, and employment is finally growing at a robust pace. And even better, the unemployment rate is actually at its lowest since April of 2008. In June, the unemployment rate fell 0.2% to, does anyone know what it is today? Very good. 5.3%, very good. Very good. Consumer confidence, which we know is a big driver of the GDP, is near an 8-year high, and improvements in the labor market continue to boost incomes. Household balance sheets are also in a much better shape than they were a few years ago because of growth in home and equity prices. Inflation is low and stable, and economic activity is expected to increase in the next quarter. Now, again, I've asked for some specific data as it relates to the Hispanic community, so I'm thrilled, again, that we put this together specifically for NCLR. So the unemployment rate for Hispanics rose more rapidly during the recession than the national average, but has fallen at a comparable pace in percentage terms from its peak. However, the unemployment rate for Hispanics remains notably higher than for the U.S. population on average. During the recession, the unemployment rate for Hispanics rose 7.2 percentage points from an average of 5.7% in 2007 to a peak of 12.9% in late 2010. It has since declined by 6.3 percentage points and currently stands at 6.6%, close to 1.25 percentage points higher than the national average of 5.3%. Real median household income for Hispanics rose in 2013 for the first time since 2009. While real median income is still well below its pre-recession peak and the U.S. average, the gap between Hispanic median income and the U.S. average has narrowed. Real median household income for Hispanics rose 3.5% in 2013 to $40,963. While this was the first noteworthy annual increase since 2006, real median income for Hispanics remains 6% below its 2006 level of $43,650. Hispanics were the only group to experience a statistically significant decline in their poverty rate in 2013. While this is welcome news, the poverty rate for Hispanics is still notably higher than its pre-recessional levels and the national average. The poverty rate for Hispanics declined 2.1 percentage points in 2013 to 23.5%, the lowest since 2008, and down from its peak of 26.5% in 2010. So while there is more that we can do, the numbers are improving, and we anticipate this to be the case in the future. And again, you'll hear more about it in the next panel. I also want to share with you a few programmatic updates that we think are very important for our community. When I took this job and I put together my proposal on why I would take this job, one of the items in my portfolio that was so important is the community development area, as I mentioned. I'm also in addition to being a senior advisor, I'm also the secretary's representative on the Community Development Financial Institution Fund, so CDFI. And as part of the CDFI board, we make decisions on everything from new market tax credits to everything that impacts financial institutions. So it's been a very big privilege to see how that program has grown so much and how much it's impacted our community. So CDFI was created to increase opportunity and promote community development investments in underserved communities under the management of Treasury. Collectively, our programs help to increase access to capital and spur local economic development in low-income urban and rural communities in all 50 states and the District of Columbia and Puerto Rico and the U.S. Virgin Islands. Does everyone know what CDFIs are? I hope you do. They're very important to what we do. So it includes community development banks, credit unions, local funds, microlenders, and venture capital funds. They exist to provide loans to individuals and families, financing for investments in job training, workforce development programs, reentry programs for small business loans, daycare centers, community centers, health facilities, grocery stores, and other fresh food options, investments, basic retail banking services, and financial literacy and training in all underserved communities. So today I want to talk about the New Market Tax Credit Program, which is very interesting for me because when I was on the real estate side in the private sector, we actually use New Market Tax Credits for urban revitalization. So it's interesting to be on the other side of the aisle here and be able to allocate funds in areas that need it the most. And so New Market Tax Credits is a flexible tool for community development organizations to fill in financing gaps, and one that I used when I was in local government along with the private sector. And the credits attract private sector investment in underserved areas that would otherwise not be possible. So New Market Tax Credits have been used to support all types of projects, including real estate development, business, healthcare facilities, workforce training centers, and jobs in urban and rural areas across the country. So I forgot to mention in my other life, I have about 15 years in economic development and redevelopment for many cities across the U.S., and one of my favorite parts of my career. And since the New Market Tax Credit Program has begun, the program's investments have created an estimated 350,000 new jobs and supported the construction of 17 million feet of manufacturing space, 50 million square feet of office space, and 40 million square feet of retail space. And also, when I talk about the CDFI program, it's always helpful to talk about some of the projects that have really spurred development, because I think it's helpful for you guys to think about what you can do and how you could be accessing some of these funds in your own neighborhoods. So in Detroit, we did the Argonaut project, which has converted a historic GM building into a 70,000 square foot mixed-use educational facility. The College of Creative Studies expansion campus features education facilities for undergraduate and graduate programs, residential facilities for up to 300 students, and an arts and design middle and high school serving approximately 900 students annually. In Sumter, South Carolina, where unemployment is 1.5 times the national average, Continental Tire's new manufacturing facility will create an estimated 1,600 new jobs over the next decade. More than $18.7 million in New Market Tax Credit financing was used for the construction of a $45 million, 180,000 square foot refrigerated warehouse in Newark, New Jersey. Another program that I love talking about that started in this administration was the State Small Business Credit Initiative, or SSBCI. And this was authorized through the Small Business Jobs Act of 2010, that authorized $1.5 billion in new funding. And this program allows states to build on successful models for state small business lending and investment programs, including capital access programs, collateral support programs, loan guarantee programs, loan participation programs, and venture capital programs. And the basis for this is that states are required to demonstrate that for every $10 in new private lending will result in the matching of the $1 in federal funding. So it's leveraging, again, this $1 federal funding against 10 times that amount in the private sector. And awards were allocated to 47 states, the District of Columbia, the five territories and municipalities in three states, and by early 2012, based on a formula set by the Small Business Jobs Act. So through 2014, participating states expended $846 million in program funds, spurring more than $6.4 billion in private sector lending and investment to small businesses. And the SSBCI funds have helped to create or save more than 141,000 American jobs. And due to the success of this program, we have submitted in the president's budget a proposal for a new authorization of $1.5 billion. So we are all hoping that that goes through, and we need your help and support to make that happen. There's a couple of other programs that I want to highlight, two of which are being featured here at NCLR. One of them is our MyRA program. You're going to hear a little bit more about pension and retirement savings, and this is one new product that the President had mentioned in the State of the Union address last year as an alternative for folks to be able to save for the future. In addition to that, we do have our Making Home Affordable program also on display here. I think there's actually booths that we have here at NCLR for those programs, so please visit those and go to treasury.gov for information on all those programs. Now, in the time that I have left, I have about 2 minutes left, and I want to talk about one other program, which is another near and dear to my heart, and Monica had alluded to it. So for those of you who don't know, I mentioned I was on the Treasury Federal Reserve Transition Team, and part of my reconnaissance was to look at an overview of Treasury and prepare it for what it was about to experience, which was at the time the height of the financial crises, and how to look at being a more programmatic organization versus a functional organization. And I came across this little bureau, the Bureau of Engraving and Printing, and I was enchanted, literally enchanted, at the history of our country and how it was represented in all our currency and coins and everything that the Treasury was producing, whether it was savings bonds or stamps or military payment certificates, and lo and behold, food stamps. So I took this job specifically to work on this Woman on 10 initiative, to put a woman on currency. So more than 6 years later, here we are. We did make the announcement earlier in June that we were moving forward with this initiative. And one of the components of this initiative, in addition to putting a woman on our currency, which hasn't happened in almost 120 years, and only then twice, will be very fundamental in terms of redefining who we are and how we want to institutionalize our memory, our history. But what I thought was really even more, I think, profound about this effort is the theme that has been approved not just for this denomination on the 10, but for all denominations, which is, again, part of my reconnaissance effort over the years to get to this point, and that is the theme of democracy. And when you think about democracy, that theme resonates for me very personally because it is supposed to represent equitable representation, equitable governance, equitable leadership. And what we learned from the financial crises and what we are learning every single day is that we can no longer do things the same, that we have no choice but to bring different voices to the table. And you can all define what different means, but I'll tell you what it means to me. Different means more women. Different means more Latinos. Different means bringing people to the table who look like us. Because if all we can know and think about are the numbers, just in numbers alone, this is what I tell my kids every day. Today, no one looks like you. Tomorrow, everyone is going to look like you. So if that's what we take away from this process, and that's why I still remain in this job almost 7 years, is to bring that point home. So to all of you, thank you again so much for what you do. Thank you, Janet. Thank you, Monica. Thank you to all of you for setting the stage for this economic dialogue that lives and breathes in us every single day, and there is so much more to come. Thank you.
I can't think of a better way to set the stage for what will be our panel discussion. I really want to thank again the Honorable Rosie Rios, United States Treasurer. Pretty extraordinary to have a Latina with that kind of passion and commitment to our community serving the administration in this way. So as we invite our panel to come forward, I just want to sort of set the stage a little bit. We all talk about how important it is for our community to accumulate wealth. And wealth matters, you know, what you own versus what you owe. Wealth matters at the family level. It provides a kind of security for us to be able to get ahead in our communities, to get our kids into college, to save for retirement. Wealth matters at the individual family level. But wealth also matters as a nation because it will be what ensures our ability to compete economically and our ability to ensure that we are all part of this conversation. And unfortunately, what we've seen is as we've come out of the economic recession and we are now in this recovery, we continue to have this gap. And I know that our treasurer mentioned a few data points. I just wanted to give you a couple that just are, they're mind-boggling. Because, in fact, as we've come out of this recession, between 2010 and 2013, income levels, the median household income level for white families grew. And it grew to almost $140,000 as the median income level. During that same period, as we're coming out of this recession, unfortunately, not only is it just a wealth gap, it's a racial wealth gap. And in fact, during that same period of time, household income dropped for both Latinos and African American families, and currently stands at an average for our Latino families of just $13,700. So it is real, and you all, as leaders in our community, feel it every single day. We have the great advantage of having a panel with us that will bring this down to a community level, to a state level, and to a federal level, because we're going to talk about what to do next around this growing problem. So let me now go over to my chair and introduce our panel. So as I said, we have a great opportunity to talk with individuals that have the ability to make a difference. And they're going to talk both from a policy point of view, and I hope they also share some personal reflections on what this means. I'm going to start down to my far right. We have with us the Honorable Martin Chavez from the great state of New Mexico. And as many of you know, Martin Chavez served both in the state legislature, was the mayor of Albuquerque twice over. And while he was mayor, he in fact not only led in the economic development opportunity, but really also focused on the broader issues of water, the environment, and ensuring that our economies are both inclusive and sustainable. And so I'd like to welcome the Honorable Mayor Martin Chavez. And somebody who I think everybody in this room knows, and if you don't, you should know, Maria Pesqueira, who leads one of our great affiliates in the Chicago area. Maria, of course, is the CEO of Mujeres Latinas en Acción from Chicago. She herself is an extraordinary leader. You should all applaud her. I got to know Maria because we served on the board of NCLR together, and of course, we were on the executive committee together at the same time. But Maria has not only become one of the national leaders in terms of nonprofits, national nonprofits, but the work that they do on the ground in community development, working with Latinas in particular and giving them the tools to succeed. So our goal is to have Maria talk from the point of view of community-based organizations and what we can do to overcome the factors that contribute to income inequality. And to my immediate right, we have the Honorable Emmanuel Cleaver. And back in your hometown, in the Honorable Cleaver's neighborhood, of course, Congressman Cleaver has been in office for many years, was the mayor of Kansas City, and under his leadership brought great economic development. In fact, reading from your bio, this was sort of the pivotal cornerstone of what his administration was going to refer to, and in fact brought transportation, used redevelopment dollars, and really tried to focus on improving economic opportunities here at the local level, and took that same passion with him to Washington, D.C., where he now serves in Congress and sits on the subcommittee for finance, as well as leadership roles in a number of other caucuses, including the minority whip, as well as a former chair of the Congressional Black Caucus. So our panel today. So great, that's exactly the kind of response we want from you. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna start out and allow each one of our distinguished panelists to give us some opening remarks. We've asked them to limit it to 5 minutes. We know that those of you who are in elected office know how to read the time clock. And so So we're going to have opening remarks. I'm going to start with Congressman Cleaver, and we're going to talk among ourselves. We've got some prepared questions, obviously, but then we do want to open it up to you, and we've got microphones set up around the room where we do hope for the last 20 minutes or so of this town hall, it really is a town hall, and we can converse and hear from you. So, Congressman Cleaver, I'll start with you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, and I appreciate the invitation to be with you at this conference and convention. And we in Kansas City feel a strong tie to Lozano because of your CEO, Janet Marghia, being from this village, and we are very proud of her. There's no question that the U.S. economy is growing. There is absolutely no question about it. But minorities are lagging behind. And worse, the wealth gap is actually widening. And we'll hopefully get into that during the questions and answers. And I serve on the House Financial Services Committee. It used to be called the Banking Committee. And I also am the ranking member on housing and insurance. And we end up having these arguments every week. And if your life is boring and you watch C-SPAN during during the day, you may see some of this. But I'm in a committee hearing, and somebody actually stands up and begins to attack public housing and affordable housing programs. And all the information they are spouting is wrong. The average person stays in a public housing unit 6 years, and the majority of the people in public housing are the disabled, the elderly, and children. But if the facts don't fit, then bit by bit, refit the facts. Mm-hmm. And that's what happens in Washington. I work in a fact-free environment. And in 1937, Franklin Delano Roosevelt made a radio speech, and he said that he was going to be attacked by all the wealthy people in the world because he had just successfully gotten through the first minimum wage, 25 cents an hour. Mm. Since 1938, we've gone $7 higher. $7 higher. Nothing that cost 25 cents in 1938 can you buy today for $7.25. Nothing. And so the struggles that we have are continuing. Now I was on the committee when we had the economic collapse. I was sitting in the room. I'll never forget it if I live to be 1,000 years old. I'm sitting there in my seat along with other members of the committee. And Barney Frank is the chair. In walks Hank Paulson. Behind him is Ben Bernanke. And behind him is Sheila Bair. This is FDIC, the Fed, and President Bush's Treasury Secretary. And then Cox comes in from the Securities and Exchange Commission. And then Hank Paulson said, President Bush has sent me over to tell you that if we can't get some things done by next week when the Asian markets open, we could be in a worldwide depression. My first thought was, I didn't sign up for this. I want to go home. I mean, I got children. I don't need this. And then I realized that we had to take some dramatic actions. It cost our nation $13 trillion. $13 trillion. In economic loss, economic growth that we did not have, and $16 trillion in household loss or wealth associated with households, $16 trillion. And you and I were the victims of most of that, which we can get to in later. Now, because time is running out and I'd rather answer questions anyway, let me just say, in my real life, I'm a seminary graduate. I pastored churches most of my life, just came from church here. And I've heard people say, money is the root of all evil, which is a misquote anyway. But let's assume that it's correct, which most people believe. That's not what the Bible says, but that's okay. But saying money is the root of all evil is crazy. Brokenness is the root of all evil.
Okay.
And as the conversation goes along, I'll prove it. Thank you.
Thank you. Besides being eloquent, Congressman Cleaver reminded us it's Sunday, so I want to go next to Maria Pesqueira, of course, who for your opening remarks.
Great. Thank you, Monica. And thank you, Congressman, for your points. First of all, I just want to remind folks that there really, we know that income inequality really is stimulated by three areas, and I kind of want to bring it down to the fact that those three key areas are related to education, assets, and specifically when we talk about assets, home ownership, right? I know we talk a lot about that, and the labor market. So related to education, right? College education is all but required to flourish in our labor market. We know this. But the gap in college attainment by whites versus blacks and Latinos has widened even more over the last decade, meaning that 34% of whites completed a four-year college degree, while African Americans 20%, Latinos 13%. So we certainly know we have obstacles related to that, and we have seen some increases with college attainment with Latinos, but we still have a great way to go. Now, I also want to mention that obtaining a bachelor's degree sometimes isn't enough for Latinos, right? In order for Latinos to escape the racial wealth gap, what I came to realize, which was shocking, is that a return on investment, really, because we're talking about ROI, a return on investment in college is much greater for whites than there are for African Americans and Latinos. Specifically for Latinos, we're only talking about a $4,191 increase, while for whites it's close to $56,000. So why is that? You know, obviously part of that has to do, going back, it's like the circle related to, we know, we go back to the recession, one of the things that hit hardest was home equities, right? Many Latino families were tapping into home equities in order to borrow and go to college. So now the loan debts continue to go higher and higher just to be able to do. That's just one piece of it. Now, I mentioned assets as being a part of it, and certainly we talk about wealth and savings, but when you have less money bringing in, you have much less to save. When your home equity is almost none, you have much less to tap into. And then I want to specifically go into the labor market, which is really key for folks. First of all, I want to mention that 57.2% of women are low-wage workers. So I work in Mujeres Latinas en Acción, and certainly I want to highlight women, but families in general. And so what Monica brought up earlier about the $13,000 on a house income, it is not shocking for us. We saw the average income of many single head of household women of four is $17,500. Mm-hmm. That's pretty severe. So we do know that of those 57.2 women that are low-age workers, they're not making enough to make up to keep their families out of poverty, and it is exaggerated amongst Latinas. So what is it specifically within the labor market that is something that we have to keep in mind? And certainly, we know that Latinas make 60 cents to a dollar a white man makes, right? We know that. And so why is that? Well, let's go back to the fact that Latinos happen to be, I mentioned that you will start out with a college degree making less than already your counterpart, right? We also know that we have a number of folks in minimum wage work in the service area. Well, we've got to increase the minimum wage if we want more money in our families' pockets, right? So we do know And then you take a look at tipped workers, right? 61.2% of tipped workers are waiters and waitresses, and they are many times making below the minimum wage. So we've got to figure out how to increase the tipped wages work. In Chicago, and some of this information you could look online in our to get, because I only got 30 seconds left, but we did work specifically on the wage work increase. But you can go on our webpage, and there is a Latina portrait specifically looking at the minimum wage work. And obviously, the paid time off policy is important. I mean, the fact that many folks in this country that's really are not able to take a day off, even though they're sick, or consider going with even less money. So the issue, we know that there are some, there is the Family Leave Act that is being considered or at this point, and there are some opportunities that we'll talk a little bit more about during the question and answer. But, you know, there is, in all of this, I still want to say that our community is still a powerful community, right? We have $1.3 trillion in purchasing power. Imagine if more money was brought into it, what we could be able to do.
Great. Thank you, Maria. Let me turn it over to Honorable Martin Chavez.
Sure. Well, thank you so much, and I'm very pleased to be here. I didn't learn this lesson. I've learned it many times, but not well, because the congressman and I were mayors together at the same time, and all the mayors knew, don't ever get on the same podium. with the mayor, because he's just so good, I'm going to learn that lesson one day. Maybe when you leave office, I want to talk briefly about a different type of divide and inequality. One of the hats I wear right now is as a senior advisor for the Hispanic Technology and Telecommunications Partnership. We are an umbrella organization of 19 national Latino organizations weighing in on all things FCC, because we have this thing called the internet, and beyond that, all things internet, and it is critical if Latinos are going to be part of the future economy and the global economy. It's not well known, but that Latinos of all groups, minority, non-minority, are over-indexed on smartphones. We use smartphones more than any other group of Americans. It's amazing. But we're under-indexed when it comes to access to high-speed internet at home. Yeah. And what are some of the things you can't do on a smartphone? You can't really apply for a job. You can't do your homework on a smartphone. And so we're seeing generations of young Latinos who are being passed by. And if you're not on the internet, you're not going to be a part of the new economy, pure and simple. And I look out, and I've spent most of my time in Washington, across to the other side of the continent, at the Silicon Valley, and I see these marvelous, I was at an event one time where the speaker for the Silicon Valley is five young white guys that run everything. And when they come out with their numbers and say, oh, it's 2%, 3%, we're trying to do better, bull. They don't just hire people that write code or engineers, they hire lawyers, accountants, all of these things. And we're being excluded from all things internet. And that's extraordinarily important. I was never a big fan of Robert Reich. You all know who he was, former Secretary of Labor, mostly because he seemed so small for such a large ego. But I can talk about small people. But I rewatched his movie from last year, just the other night, Income Inequality or Inequality for All, and he made some extraordinary points. How in the 50s and 60s, and you went to college and you became more productive, that wealth was yours. You realized it. But in today's economy, you work just as hard, you go to college, you are more productive, and Americans work harder than any nation on earth, but that productivity doesn't result in income and wealth accumulation in our community. It ends up in somebody else's hand. And he also made the point that there are 400 Americans who have exactly as much wealth as half of all of America. Now, that's a system that isn't functioning properly. That's a system that is broken. John Kennedy said, things don't just happen, people make them happen. And good things happen because people make them happen, and bad things happen because people make them happen. We find ourselves today in this system of inequity by design. It is a policy, and it's incumbent upon us as Latinos, using the power we have, the purchasing power, absolutely, for crying out loud, the power of the ballot, actually getting out and voting, and speaking truth to power. It's not enough anymore for any Americans just to go to college, and I agree, college does better for non-minorities than it does for minorities, but if you want to actually have that wealth accumulation that was a reality in the 60s and early 70s, certainly the late 50s, now it's graduate school. And it's kind of what most parents tell their kids. Hito, hita, stay in school. Mm-hmm. You've got to stay in school. So we educate ourselves, we stay online, but then we really have to speak truth to power and say, it's not fair, and we're not gonna take it anymore. There are real things, real behaviors that we can engage in as a community that will lift our community up. These economies aren't top down, they're the middle out, and we need to remind people that consumers control this country's destiny.
Bob, thank you. These are some really powerful concepts, and I want to come back to hopefully as much of them as we can. But you know, we've talked about home ownership and assets that convert into wealth. We've talked about education, income, speaking truth to power, the financial crisis. I guess I'd like to start with income, because Maria, you brought up this point that, you know, we are pretty much concentrated in low wage, low income sectors of the economy. And there is this movement that is a national movement to elevate the minimum wage. And you made reference to it at the federal level, where we're still at seven something, and yet cities across this country have actually taken it upon themselves to say, it's not fair. Mm-hmm. And so Chicago has done it, Los Angeles has done it, Seattle has done it. And I guess I'd like to hear from you, maybe Maria, I don't know how close you were to the actual movement, because I don't think things don't happen in City Hall mm-mm. without there being a movement mm-hmm. on the ground behind it. So maybe you can talk a little bit about what actually drove the city of Chicago to adopt a minimum wage ordinance. And then maybe we can talk about what are the prospects for this at the federal level, and if not here, what else can we do to increase the income of our families?
Sure. So in Chicago, as of July 1st, we're in the first week, it's gone from $8.25 an hour to $10 an hour, and it will go up to $13 gradually, and then we'll be pegged into inflation. Mujeres has been very much a part of this. Yes, there was the Fight for 15 battle, and that was very difficult, and it's really interesting because part of it comes down to where many of our families are in situations where childcare is associated to your income, right? And you're basically living or other benefits, and just moving something up from a $1 amount to another dollar amount means a huge gap of dollars lost in benefits. So those are some of the things that we saw as we've been working on this, that is also a challenge that while you're working on things at the local level, you still have to go hand in hand with some of the public benefits and what is considered poverty at the national level. Also at the local level, the idea of there was a referendum. When you talk about the power of the vote, we had a referendum and the majority of the voters said in Chicago, yes, we should have a paid time off policy. So it is important for folks to be involved and use the power of the ballot and referendums. And I think we still have a long way to go. The fact that $13 even today, or even $10, still does not get folks out of poverty.
Congressman Cleaver.
Well, the United States is ranked 30th in terms of income inequality. which translated into the fact that we are more unequal than 70% of the 195 sovereign republics or nations around the world. We've got to deal with the whole issue of the minimum wage and all of the misinformation that goes out. Every time this comes up, you can hear people talking about, oh, it's going to cost jobs, and these are kids. Here are the facts, and I got this from the Economic Policy Institute. The average minimum wage person is 36 years old. Adult. 37% are over 40, 56% are women, 28% have children, and 57% work full-time jobs. This is it. This is not a part-time job as they would have you believe. These are people who get up every single morning and stand out in the snow and the rain, catching buses, going to work, and they can't hardly make enough money to pay for the bus they rode. And when you hear people plotting and planning to fight against minimum wage, and we're having a fight here in Kansas City right now, it is absolutely obscene that there are folk who would like to continue to pay people a minimum wage. We have a major, one of the largest stores in the world just raised the minimum wage, and then went around doing this for the next month. They barely raised it. We're going to have some difficulty getting a minimum wage approved in Washington. Why? Because they're just like the people in Missouri. The Missouri General Assembly failed to approve a minimum wage bill, but they did not flunk in reducing corporate taxes by 5%, 0.5%. And what they do is they vicariously identify with folk who have, you know, like, well, my ship is coming in. You know, well, you don't even have water for the ship to come in. Many of the people, they're poor, but they vote as if they were rich because that's where they want to go. And they don't understand that the system is just not going to allow them to get there because that's not the system we're living under right now.
Mayor Chavez, I want to thank you. Because I think you brought up the point that it's not just raising the minimum wage, but it's what kinds of jobs do we have access to, and where are we employed, and what are the sectors where you see growth, and are we competing for those? And so you made reference to Silicon Valley and telecommunications and sort of the new economy. What do you see as the opportunity for opening those doors, the new economy doors, in engineering and in these new sectors? To our community, what are the barriers and what do we do?
Well, I don't know any instance in history where power was given. Power is taken. And if you're not happy with the situation around you, we organize. We know how to do that. And that's how change is created. Let me give you a little background, historical background, on at least minimum wage from a municipal perspective. That movement came out of, I think it was a Saul Alinsky type of operation out of Chicago. And almost every single mayor in America was opposed to it. Rich Daley led the fight. Congressman, I don't know where you were at, but yeah. I was against it at the time because, come on, that's a federal issue. Right. We don't do that at the city level. I think only San Francisco was supporting it. Of course, none of us had any inkling that Washington would just simply refuse to do its job. And so now I think every mayor supports just about raising minimum wages at the local level. It's an imperfect tool, ought to be in the federal domain. It's not, so be it. But there's another part of the equation that we miss, and that is how much are the wealthiest of Americans paying in taxes? That's right. They are not paying their fair share. So if you increase the wage of working Americans so that they can consume goods, presumably the goods that these wealthy folks are manufacturing for us. Actually, we manufacture it too. We're the workers. And then you make them pay their fair share. Well, then we can invest in schools, and we can invest in educating our kids in the best practices online so that they can access this new economy. I think all things internet is just essential for communities of color. Because otherwise, here in about 5 years, we're going to look back and we're going to see who has those jobs and who doesn't. And we know that story. We've been through that narrative. And unless we speak up, unless we are active, that will be the narrative.
Well, this issue of tax policy, and I don't know, Congressman, you may want to refer to it, but at least in my readings, the state of Kansas has found itself in a huge deficit because it moved towards a zero tax environment and got there precisely by balancing its budget on the backs of the poor and the working class here in Kansas. I want to go back to...
Missouri.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Yes. I'm sorry.
No, the only reason I mention that is I don't want to be over there with the governor.
I just thought you might want to reference the, yes, exactly. Let's not make any mistakes. We're talking about Kansas and we're in Missouri. Maria, I actually wanted to talk with you about this question of home ownership because the reference was made earlier and you emphasized it around assets. And so coming out of the crisis, I mean, it really was led by a collapse of the housing market. And in fact, people had gotten into loans that they shouldn't have been in and, you know, subprime lending, et cetera. And now you have, you know, this reduction in home ownership rates for Latino and African American families, but you also have banks that are reluctant to lend precisely because of of the problems that had come into before. So are you doing work in this area of home ownership? What do we see as some of the new tools that we might be able to build assets?
Sure, we certainly partner with organizations in the community, such as the Resurrection Project in Chicago and other groups, but we know that foreclosures hit our communities really hard, and so some folks are just coming out of that. But even folks who have been in their homes for years, making their mortgages, find themselves where they are no longer having the equity that they need. I also wanted to share with you some of the things that we've seen with folks living. It shows just the creativity of our community in trying to make ends meet, and also speaks about the entrepreneurial spirit. During this process, we talked to many women and families, and what we were finding is that not only were they working these long hours and minimum wage jobs, but they were doing these micro businesses that were, you know, making tamales and pozole, sewing, doing this, doing that, that really speaks about that spirit of entrepreneurship. And I think that if we continue to also look at the fact that also encouraging, because certainly if in the market they're not making enough money to make it, some folks ended up starting their own businesses this way. So I think the idea of not only investing in assets like home ownership, but investing in the micro business and moving them to small businesses. We have a program at Mujeres Latinas en Acción called Mujeres Empresarias that has really just developed because of that same kind of spirit.
I think that's a really important point. And in fact, the data shows that coming out of the recession, Latinos were starting businesses at much higher rates than others, precisely because if you couldn't get a job, I'll start my own business. And that's why you saw these rates of self-employment go up. The Treasurer also talked about tools like CDFIs and other things that might be able to stimulate community development. Congressman, could you talk about access in terms of financial instruments that we could leverage and bring into our communities to help close some of this?
Well, first of all, I think that the greatest investment that we can make as minorities, and we won't be minorities long, but for the time being, I think is home ownership. Here's the way I would suggest that we think about it, that if you invested in Wall Street or in anything, you still got to go out and find a place to live, and you got to pay rent and pay, for a place to live. If you buy a home, you actually are paying yourself rent, and because God didn't make any more dirt, you own something that cannot be reproduced. And so I think that's one of the things that we've got to do. And the FHA right now is healthier than it's ever been. It has about $40 billion right now that it can use, about $4.5 billion in reserves. The interest rate is the down payment is about 3.5%, and the mortgage insurance is also down. I mean, this is a good time. We did this because we were the ones who were hurt more, and I think this is a way that we can recapture some of the wealth and then use that to go into more and more businesses. And we also have a ready clientele for many of the businesses that we will create.
So do you see lending beginning to open up using FHA or other federally backed loans?
Yes, FHA now is doing more business than it was doing before the financial collapse. Before the collapse, they had about 3% of the housing or the mortgage business. Now it's up to about 40. Now it's going to drop a little, and it should. But most of those new home buys or the new buyers are us. And you're going to hear people, there's a fight in Congress that you need to be aware of. There's something called the PATH Act that's in our committee. It would move the down payment up from 3.5 to 20%. If house payments are 20%, most of us, most of us who were mayors can't afford use a 20%, make a 20% down payment. And so there are things that are going, that are working in our benefit if we are aware of them.
Here, I want to ask you to weigh in on home ownership, small business. What do you see as the key ways to stimulate local economic?
Well, I simply guess I'm for all of those things. Let me come at it from this direction, and please correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe the second largest body of debt in America today that Americans have is education debt.
Yeah.
Second only to homeowner to what you owe on your home. And so we have young people finishing college. We have young people not going to college because they're looking down the road at what their obligations are going to be, making the same decisions about graduate school. But they go through it, go to law school, whatever it may be. We've got enough lawyers. Not enough Latino lawyers, just enough
lawyers. Right.
How are they going to buy a home? When you have individuals in their mid-30s, presumably raising families, they're still paying off their college debt, not making provision for their kids to go in. And so anything we can do to get people right side up financially in their homes. Told this story briefly backstage. We have one little section of Albuquerque is near the Air Force Base. And back in the early 70s, the city made a decision to do a lot of rental zoning to accommodate the military because it's a very transient community. Well, we ended up with a very transient community. So we ended up with high crime. We ended up with people that weren't invested in their neighborhoods. And it just sets off a whole series of issues. So home ownership, I think, is still critical to the American dream. It's critical to stable neighborhoods, prosperous cities. And then there is something that can be handed on to another generation besides billions and billions of dollars of unearned wealth.
Congressman, let me come to you because so much of this can be moved forward at a local level, at the community-based organization level, but we do depend on the federal government to set a lot of these policies. And you made reference to living in a fact-free environment. You know, how optimistic should we be? What can we see coming out of the federal government to alleviate student loans, home ownership, small business development, the minimum wage? I mean, these are all big issues, and so many of them reside at the federal level. Can we help in any way?
Well, I think we can help by making sure that we are educated on what's going on in Washington. Sometimes African Americans have higher voter participation if they're angry. Mm-hmm. And no, not Latinos, just us. But there's plenty to be angry about, and I think that's how we're going to have to make some of the changes. When you think about it, you know, the default rate on college loans is higher than the default rate on homes right now. And then the government, the federal government, we can't get it changed in Congress, is actually making money off of the student loans. It is obscene that the federal government is piling up money at the expense of sending our kids to colleges. And then on the other hand, it's going to be difficult for us to get things. The president's trying to do some things, for example, with the overtime rule. If you're not familiar with it, what the president is trying to do is to create, through the Labor Department, a system whereby if you earn a certain amount of money, everything above a certain amount of money would be overtime. George Bush had it at $455 a week. In other words, if you made more than $455 a week, you couldn't get overtime. Well, just think about this. $2,000 a month is, you're going to end up with $24,000 a year. And I'd like to have $24,000 in my pocket. But what family in 2015 is going to survive with any degree of flexibility with $24,000 a month? And so he's trying to get this through. It's not in place now because right now we're in what's called the rulemaking period. But it's going to be fought all the way. Everything progressive that we're trying to do, from minimum wage to overtime pay, to trying to reduce this wealth gap. I live in Washington, D.C. Chevy Chase, Maryland, has an average income of $466,000.
Wow.
And in Washington, where I live, you can't walk two blocks without stepping over somebody laying on the sidewalks without a place to live.
Well, we are going to get ready to take questions from the audience. So if any of you have questions, please start standing, coming up to the mic. I was going to ask one last question, but please come on forward and let's get started with the audience. And if you want to introduce yourself, state your name, and maybe where you're from, and then we'll
Sure. I'm coming from California, where lots of Google and all the big corporations are. My name is Alicia Contreras. I am the new director of the Spanish-Speaking Citizens Foundation. And as a nonprofit, and hearing all what you are saying, the one thing that I'm thinking is there are no jobs for everybody in those big corporations. I think that a lot of employments are with our small nonprofits, and our staff is completely underpaid. That is a fact. And taxes are killing us. Right now, I'm actually struggling to pay my payroll next day to pay. And I think that we really, really need an emergency, tax policy that actually promotes that small companies, small nonprofits, can actually make it. Because my other choice is to lay off a lot of staff, and that's what I don't want to do. So I'm curious to know.
Do you want to just talk about the viability and how to maintain the nonprofit sector so that they thrive as small businesses?
Sure. Well, you know, first of all, as nonprofits, that's why I like the word organizations for public good, as opposed to for public profit, right? Because whenever there's a non before the profit, it's assumed that we are trying to go in a deficit. We are organizations who we are small businesses, we employ individuals, we pay taxes, and when we have to lay people off, guess what? They've got to seek out unemployment, and we certainly are the ones paying into the tax system, into our employees' benefits and fringes. But, speaking about nonprofit situations at this point in a place like Illinois, I come from Illinois, is a really kind of sore spot for us right now. We're in a situation where even in Illinois, we don't have a budget. And so it goes back to folks who are sent out to represent an entire state have specific interests, whether it's from a governor to a general assembly. And it goes back to, we need to make sure that our voices are heard, right? That our elected officials know why they're sent there, and that we are businesses as well. And that when we hurt, everyone hurts, not just the people we serve, but also the economy.
Let's go to our next question. Thank you, Maria.
I'm David Valladolid with the Parent Institute for Quality Education, PICA, and we educate parents how to guide their children to universities. I just want to say that your incredible presentations this afternoon have reinforced to me the fact that we have a political system that's the best money can buy. And the reality is there's a growing movement in our nation that we create a situation where elected officials are publicly supported in terms of their elections, and no one is allowed for any corporation or any individual to give millions and billions of dollars. So I'd like you to respond, if we can change our political system where anyone running for office is publicly supported and not controlled by the 1%, will that in fact change the direction of our nation?
Anybody want to take it, Marty?
I think you got to take the money out of politics. And I think the Supreme Court, frankly, is just wrong. I think the ACLU is simply wrong when they say that Citizens United should be the policy for this country. Money is not speech. Speech is speech. Money is money. But we have to find our way through that. Quagmire is the wrong term, but we have a Supreme Court precedent, and we have a Supreme Court that is comprised a certain way, that is the law of the land. And so public financing can work to a limited extent in some local jurisdictions. But right now, we have one big bad federal policy that is an obstacle to comprehensive reform, and that policy has got to be changed. Mm-hmm. Some have advocated constitutional amendment to do it. I'm for that. I just think we need a Supreme Court that interprets the Constitution properly.
I'm going to just ask, because we have a long line, and I think this is great, and we want everybody to. So let's make sure that you keep your questions precise. And are there lights in the back? Because it would be very helpful so that we could actually see the people at the microphone. But please, your question.
Thank you. My name is Araceli Panameño. I'm with the Center for Responsible Lending, and I want to thank Representative Cleaver for being a tremendous ally to the Latino community and to middle-class and low-income families across the country. Thank you, sir. We know that many, many Americans are being shut out of credit markets, and when I speak about credit markets, I want to make sure that I am precise about good credit, particularly the mortgage market. And so I have a two-part question. One, what can the Financial Services Committee, and how can we help you support your efforts to make sure that we continue to have access to credit, good credit, and access to capital? And secondly, on the consumer protection side, Latinos and African Americans are being targeted for markups in the auto lending market. Would you support bills to ban interest rate markups in auto lending and HMDA-type data requirements? Thank you, sir.
Yes, thank you. First of all, during the financial crisis, and we began to fight this issue because Latinos and African Americans were targeted in this whole crisis that was created, because they had less experience in dealing with mortgages. And so the whole design was to make a loan, and they wanted the loan to go bad. Why? Because when it went bad, you're back in 3 years getting it refinanced. We have a situation in Kansas City that I worked with. A woman bought a $90,000 home. She was a bus driver. She made $8 an hour, and she had payments like $300 or $400, I don't remember what they were now. And the guy who sold her the loan said, well, you know, Will, why don't you start out, you pay $150 a month. I think you can do that. And she said, oh yeah, I can make that. And he said, and then in about 3 years, you'll get a raise, and we'll raise it up to $500. And so she's her home, she's so excited. Well, she's not gonna make $500 driving a bus. So what happens is that, you know, we're taken advantage of. But La Raza, when we start these hearings, they were there testifying at almost every single hearing, making sure that the opinions that we're hearing here were being shared right there in the House of Representatives. It was the La Raza and the Urban League were there just, I mean, almost all day and all night, anytime this issue raised. We don't have enough time for me to get into to detail on the rest of your question. I apologize.
Maybe we can get the two of you together afterwards. But we've got the questions around auto lending and the access to the credit markets. Do we have a question here?
Yes. My name is Veronica Villa, Senora, and I'm from Brighton Park Neighborhood Council in Chicago. And my question is for Mr. Chavez. What can cities do to ensure that the residents, regardless of their immigration status, contribute and thrive? Thank you.
Well, I think that every city ought to pass an ordinance that says we will do our jobs as local governments in stopping and arresting bad people, and we will let the federal government do their job when it comes to ICE. That's not a local government issue, and it's not one that the local government is funded for. We all know about unfunded mandates. And so that's something, though, it's easy to say, but it has to be really reinforced through the ranks of every city employee, everyone who responds to a city council or a mayor. Their job is not to be looking out for people who are, you know, driving while brown. Their job is to be enforcing regulations fairly, and for the police to making the stops when there's behavior that indicates violation of the law. I hope that answers the question.
Yes, that was good. Thank you. Is there a question?
Yes, Tom Du Bois, Calumet Area Industrial Commission, also in Chicago. I just want to get back to the issue of stagnant incomes and stagnant wages, and I think you were addressing it in terms of raising the minimum wage. Yesterday, we heard from the governor of Missouri about the large Ford assembly plant just north of here. I think it's the largest in the world, and those are union workers making good wages. I just wonder if, you know, what accounts for the situation of stagnant wages, particularly as the economy is heating up, it's a tighter labor market, and you think the labor market would function in a way that, you know, the wages would start to rise. So why isn't it rising? And would you consider support for measures to increase the ability of labor to organize and to also fight against the some of the policy measures that we've seen for labor not to be able to function very well as the right to work and getting rid of prevailing wage and those kind of measures?
I think Americans are making a terrible, terrible mistake, and our children will suffer because of it, and that is the slow dismantling of organized labor. And what's happening is that it's being done, and because people are buying into, I mean, other labor unions are working trying to raise the standard of living for their members. And every time you read that somebody, a new company, will not require that that the people pay into the labor union, what happens is that a small group of people who are paying the money and they're getting increases and better working conditions for everybody, and these other folks are laying back, taking advantage of it. Look, we need labor unions, and we're going to find ourselves in a few years trying to reorganize organized labor because we're going to kill it, and because we're siding with the folk who don't want to pay us in the first place. And, you know, Moses was the first labor organizer. and I think, you know, I mean, it's theological. You don't pay, we go home. That was Moses' position. And I think, you know, he was AFCIO president. And we need to get to the point where I'm serious, where we think about it in theological terms, that we are doing something that is right, that's helping the poorest people, and working conditions are not going to improve unless somebody is fighting the corporate leaders, because it's in their best interest not to pay you.
Unfortunately, we are about to run out of time. We're going to take one last question and then wrap up. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Elba, and I work at East LA Community Corporation, Los Angeles. And my question is to anybody that would answer it about integrating immigrants into the economy. So what kinds of immigrant integration policies or programs do you think will make a difference in addressing the economic challenges that immigrants face?
Good question. Maria,
thank you. Sure. Well, so the idea of integrating immigrants begins with sort of the simplest of naturalization, right? We want to make sure we want to increase. There are several legal residents in this country who couldn't become U.S. citizens, and we have to encourage them to become U.S. citizens. The idea that immigrants, many of our families are already bilingual, and it is to encourage the fact that we have this strength and that we have this viability that we can continue to contribute, and meaning that while many times our communities are losing opportunities to keep that second language, it's some of the more affluent communities who are learning a second language, it's keeping that in place. It is the idea of helping immigrants understand how to integrate into the various systems that are available to them, including how to navigate school systems, how to navigate public policy systems, and many times it begins with our nonprofit communities. Many of our affiliates are doing just that. We are integrating many immigrants and making sure that their voices are heard and in the system. So I could go on and on. I get really excited about immigrant integration because that's what we do on a day-to-day.
So I want everybody to help me thank this extraordinary panel. And there's a lot of factors, and I think we covered a lot of them, everything from home ownership to student loans to the financial crisis and access to credit and capital. But I heard a couple of things. One says, speak truth to power, and make sure that you lift up your voices. And it really is about a fairness question, and we have the opportunity to make our voice be heard, whether it's NCLR and the Urban League coming and making sure that they're at congressional hearings, it's at the local level, it's working in city government, and it's making sure that all of us understand that it's not one single answer. This is a big, complex issue, and all of us working together to lift up our voices. And so thank the panel, and thank you all for being here. Very nice. Thank you so much.